thank you for coming. Thank you, Unreal and Epic, for having us here. My name is Carlos Cristerna. I work at Neoscape. At Neoscape, we do architectural visualization. Architectural visualization, as you know, is typically an offline rendering situation. It takes a lot of time of computing power, and our clients really demand very high-quality visuals. So what I want to show you today is a demo that we did in conjunction with Unreal, NVIDIA, and Lenovo, trying RTX, real-time ray tracing. So we grabbed a data set that we used to have from a client of ours that we have used to create the film, create renderings, the whole thing in the offline world, you know, on a CPU render farm, and bring that into Unreal Engine through Datasmith and see if we could break it and see what happened. How far could we push the quality of the visuals, and can we tell the typical story that we tell of the properties that our clients either are constructing or own. All right, so I'm gonna hit play. This is the actual working file, and we'll see how that goes. So this is 425 Park Avenue in New York City. It's a Norman Foster building. And we did this project for a client of ours, L&L Holdings, the owner of the building. And typically our clients want fly-throughs, right? Typically they want some marketing material to either rent their buildings, sell their buildings, or win a competition. And they typically want everything that we do very fast, right? So it's always a very difficult back and forth in between our, you know, clients that are architects or our clients that are owners, right, of buildings. So this is all ray traced. This is all global illumination, reflections, refractions. Everything is being ray traced in real time and rendered in two screens. So I'm gonna teleport right here, look up at this building, and this file is being lit by an HDRI, right? So you could change the HDRI to affect the scene immediately and change the lighting. See what your materials are going to be looking like. See what your building is going to look like. So if there's two avenues you can go here. So if you're a designer, if you're working on specific materials, material properties, what are they going to look like, you know, at different times of day and things like that. If we're working at a place like Neoscape and we're working on an animation, the art director and the 3D artist can go in and do all of these exercises in real time. So obviously, the typical path that we follow on any building is outside, going to the lobby, up to the office building, and then maybe show some amenities, and then, you know, go back out and show the building. So that's what I'm going to try to do here. So we're outside. I'm going to hit enter right here and go into a different level. So this is the lobby. And you notice that when I move, if you go look up on the up left corner, there's two numbers there, the frames per second and the resolution. So when I'm moving, I am lowering the resolution because everything is ray traced to 50% of the pixels of the screening which is being shown. So you can move, and then once you stop, it just goes back to the 100% of the resolution that you wanna see. And from here, like Craig was saying earlier, just like in Twin Motion, you can do a still rendering 4K in a matter of seconds of this same, you know, image. For this particular client, we did something ridiculous like this. In this case, it was important for our client to portray how tall this lobby was, right? And then the people that are going to be working on this building are typically people that were going to be, you know, working on finance and something like that. So we're like, okay, let's do a Learjet. No, that's too much. That's for the owner of the building. Let's do maybe a couple of Teslas. Okay. So that you can see how tall that that was. So that was a fun thing to do there. But, you know, something we're doing for other clients is in Unreal, doing things like this. We have a client that designs its own stores and they sell jewelry. So we do things like populating the stores to certain percentages so that they can see how it would be the store when it's 20, 30, 40, 50%, 100% occupancy, right? And see if the spaces are good enough for their staff and for their for their customers. So I'm going to show you what it looks like without ray tracing. So that's the raster reflections, which is just a, you know, a projection of a map. And that's the real-time ray trace reflections. You see we're getting 24 frames a second at 100% of the resolution. Now I'm going to go up to the office space. I'm going to teleport right here. So I turned on global illumination right there. There's nice things you can do. You can do in Unreal. We programmed this little bar right here so that we can turn on and off the specific features of real-time ray tracing. Reflections, refractions, occlusion, which is the effects that take the most computational power to make something look photorealistic. Cancel and ignore. And you know, again, just like very simple things to see what the scene could change, maybe changing the time of day, changing anything, you really can move here and no problem. Another thing that we do a lot with our clients is animations. So this is the heaviest file we have so far in this sample. So I'm gonna turn off global illumination. I'm gonna press P to play a very short animation that I made just as a case study. You know, can we make an animation out of this and then either render it in real time and or render it with a single GPU and make an animation out of it? So that's giving us 40 something frames a second at 100% resolution. So there's lights turning on and off, real-time ray trace reflections, animated objects, self-illuminated materials lighting the scene. Things that you would not necessarily be able to visualize on an offline pipeline, offline rendering pipeline. See, it's always difficult to explain to clients that what they're seeing right now is not a video. It's being rendered as we are looking, you know, we're watching it. So obviously a basketball court in a Wall Street type office, right? Because they need to really think about their stock. So let me just show you a little bit here. Just the space lit up with a self-illuminated light, material and a light. Turn global illumination back on. And like I mentioned earlier, this whole scene, we did not curate any of this for a game. We grabbed our V-Ray Max scenes, which we typically use, and literally just dragged them into Unreal with DataSmith with no regard whatsoever about optimizing furniture. Now, the one thing that we did make sure was that the same chair that was repeated was an instance, so that, you know, Unreal would know that was just one asset. That was the one thing that we did do. And we did optimize the Teslas. I just dropped a quick optimization on them so that they weren't like this ridiculous amount of polygons. But this file is millions and millions, tens of millions of polygons that you're seeing rendered in real time at the moment. Let me turn the lights back on here. So obviously, as I move, the quality degrades. But once you slow down and once you just leave it there, you know, the quality of the visuals gets a lot better. So we're going to go now. We went through the exterior, the lobby, the office space. Now we're going to go to the amenities up at the top of the building and in a different setup at night. Let's go. So this is also lit with an HDRI from the outside. The last two levels were just lit with a the standard Sun and Sky from Unreal Engine. So this is just an HDR. You can do simple things like change materials and see all the reflections and the refractions in there happening in real time. We can add moving objects and self-illuminators with more lights and see what I'm going to lower the resolution to 50% so we can see the animation in real time. So again, there's just, you know, we did just some very basic functions for these so we could adapt to the limitations of just running on one GPU, right? Changing the time of day, changing the HDR. I'm going to go outside here so you can see and go back up to 100%. And change the HDR that is lighting the scene. You'll notice that those buildings in there, those are photos, right? They're like photos on cards. And so I chose four different HDRs that were later in the day so that they would look more or less like the buildings with the lights on would belong there. So it does a pretty good job at faking it, you know, there. So you just need to be careful with that stuff. So this was quickly proving to us that we could do marketing material like this for our clients. So let me go back outside and I'll just play you one last quick animation on the exterior of the building. So once we did this, this literally was, you know, a epic Neoscape, Lenovo, NVIDIA, before the RTX cards were released to, you know, start testing these features. And so, yeah, it's all well and good. It all worked. It was awesome. But what else can we do, right? So we know it can benefit our clients. We know it can benefit us. We can benefit our pipeline. It's another great tool for us to be able to produce content on tight deadlines, you know, and of high quality content. But internally at Neoscape, you guys know, if you know us, that we try to do always very heavily curated art that is not necessarily just a fly through. Like I'm showing you here, it's just very basic. It was just about the RTX features. So I figured, let's do a little experiment. And I got a guy that is our chief creative officer and said, hey, let's make a movie. What do you mean? We're going to grab the same data set and we're going to make the movie we want for this building. It'll be just 1 minute or something like that. Okay. So I explained to him, this is the vision I have. And I need you to make me a mood board from which I'm not going to deviate. And you'll be the art director, I'll be the 3D artist, and then we're gonna get a guy that works with us doing blueprinting, and he's gonna participate in whatever capacity he can participate. And what I was trying to prove there is how can we use this technology in a creative setting with people that are not familiar with Unreal, people like me that are somehow familiar with Unreal, and a person that is very familiar with Unreal doing blueprints and programming, but is not a 3D artist, and what can come out of that? So what I'm about to show you next is that a 4 minute long animation, an abstract, you know, art piece, if you will, of this building where everything you see animated, and there's supposed to be music with it, but some is not coming through, but it doesn't matter. That's not the point of this. All right, there you go. I'll shut up. You just watch it for a second. So one of the interesting things that happened when we were doing this was the art director would come to my desk when we were doing the look and feel of this animation, and he'd say, we're used to working offline rendering, Max V-Ray, scenes to say, hey, you know, maybe it's too blue, it's too dark, it's too contrasty and all that. And he would immediately start to walk away, expecting that those changes would take a long time. And I would immediately would like just grab him by the shirt and be like, no, 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 we can do it right now. We can actually decide those things right now. And I'll show you in a second. There's like wet puddles on the street and things like that. All of those things and all of that art direction was precisely something we could do together. I didn't have to wait to render any frames to show him where the reflections were, how dark it was, how crazy it was. Was it too grainy? Are the lens flares too much? Who cares? That wasn't the point. The point was we can do a 4-minute long 4K animation in one machine. And you're seeing it render right now in real time. I did render this whole animation in one machine with a Quadro 5000 in less than an hour. 4K frames with all the post on it, fully ray traced. And that was why we did the experiment, because it was, you know, just crazy. We have a render farm of 100 CPUs that would take 2 days to do that, 4 days to do that. And that's why we did this experiment, you know, so we're quite happy with the result. It's a little bit out there. It doesn't do really anything for anyone other than we saw it. It's like, oh, neat. It looks cool. And that's that, right? But, you know, I'll show you some of the nice things about this is that everything that you're seeing was just animated and edited right here. The color grade, there's supposed to be rain. The rain's off at the moment. There's supposed to be music, it's there. But everything was right here. Everything was on in Unreal. And yes, I did use that data set that I showed you earlier, right? With the exact same lighting, I did not change anything but the color grade and just a simple idea of collaborating with people. So that was that. And just the ability to do this thing from the one platform to us was, you know, mind-blowing and something that we really enjoyed. We could make decisions right there, you know, right then and there. We did not have to worry about the hassle of doing a rendering. And that hassle, by the way, I am trying to solve it for myself and for my clients, right? So it's the frustration I feel is the same frustration our clients feel when you tell them, oh, well, I have to render. It's rendering, right? And with these, I can literally just grab my laptop, go to my client, and see, this is it. This is not a rough version of it. This is it. And we can actually make those decisions, change whatever we have to change with them. And I don't have to run back to the office and tell 10 people what the client said. So that was the purpose of this demo. I hope that you enjoyed it and that it was helpful to you.